Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for spending your evening with us for this month's SRMEG monthly webinar. We are now into July, so this is our seventh webinar this year. We have already had six webinars earlier in the year, and tonight we'll be having our seventh webinar. In August, we will be having a webinar on concrete technology, concrete strength prediction by Ms. Zhang Qingyang from Concrete AI. In September, we'll have a webinar on concrete technology again, spread concrete nozzle man certification by Louis Fraser from Hong Kong and myself in Singapore. October, we are still waiting for a potential speaker. In November, we have our ACUS event for 4 days. And in November, we have a speaker from the Tunneling Society in Malaysia, engineer Ku Chin Min, who will be talking about tunneling in Malaysia. Yeah. So by the end of this year, we will have 10 webinars. And if we have a speaker in October, we will have 11 webinars for this year. So it's a record year for us. We have webinars almost every month. Yeah. So our webinars remain free, but attendees who are non-members but wants to get the attendance email to claim for PDU or STU points will be required to pay $15 per point. All members who already paid up your yearly membership fees will get your attendance email for free. And as I mentioned, we will organize at least 9 webinars in 1 year. And last year, we had 10 webinars actually. This is the SRMEG website. So if you take a screenshot of the QR code, you can visit our website. All the latest news are there. This is the QR code for my email for any complaints or comments or suggestions. Okay, this is the ACUS 2023. Associated Research Centers for Urban Underground Space. This is an in-person event from 1st to 4th November in Singapore. And the QR code is shown there. You can visit this homepage to have a look. But I'll be showing you something from there. Okay, by now, for the ACUS event, we have all our keynote speakers confirmed. We have 6 keynote speakers. The first one is our chief planner from the URA, Ms. Adele Tan from Singapore. The second keynote speaker will be Dr. Dimitris Kaliampakos from Greece. He's the professor in the School of Mining and Metallurgical Engineering in Athens, and he's the president of ACUS. Then we have a very famous speaker, which is Mr. Arnold Dix, or Dr. Arnold Dix from Australia, and he's the current president of the International Tunneling and Underground Space Association. So he's the current president of ITA. So basically, he represents all of tunneling throughout the entire world. Yeah. And he will be coming to Singapore to speak to you as well. And we have Dr. Professor Chen Xiangsheng from China, from the Shenzhen University. And he's the Dean in the College of Civil and Transportation Engineering and Director of Underground Police Academy of Shenzhen University. And then we have Mr. Jeremy Hammond from the United Kingdom, who is the CEO of Hypertunnel. So for those who knows about Hypertunnel, this is the most special innovative company in tunneling today. Their specialty is swarm tunneling. Yeah. So swarm tunneling is using mini or micro robots to do your tunneling for you. So instead of one TBM, you have maybe 10,000 mini TBMs doing tunneling for you. So he will be one of the keynotes. And the last keynote is Mr. Dominic Perrault. He's an architect from France, and he's a member of the Institute de France and a founder of Dominic Perrault Architecture. He's very, famous architect in terms of underground space. Yeah. And then for the guest of honor, Ms. Indrani Raja, our second minister for finance and second minister for, national development. Yeah. So she will be our guest of honor. So all the important people who are coming into underground space will be in this event in November 1st to 4th. Yeah. So for those right now is they are having early bird registration. So for those who can make it in for the 3 days or 4 days in November, you will probably get something like 20 STU or PDU points. Please sign up please sign up for the early bird registration. And right now, I wanted to also share with you a message from Professor Arnold Dix, President of ITA. Hold on.
So I'm Dixon, the President of the International Tunneling and Underground Space Association. It gives me great pleasure to introduce myself. A little snip on what I'll be talking about on this tour in Singapore. So I'm originally a scientist, geologist, and also a lawyer. I'm also a professor of engineering. And my special interest is the underground, and from being a subject matter expert in the area of fire and life safety underground and in human performance underground, through to investigating disasters, even contractual matters, that's my thing. This conference, how exciting, on underground space for the next frontier. I'm going to explore, I'm going to talk to you about this adaptive underground space, embracing the challenges of course, a changing planet in terms of urbanization, climate change, and more. My little trick, I'm also going to talk to you about the benefits of the underground space for frontier scientific research, which is going to propel our civilization future. So I'm very excited, looking forward to joining you in Singapore in November 2023. See you there.
So all these people are coming to Singapore. So for those who can join this event, please sign up for the early bird registration and come and join us. It will be everything about underground. Yeah. And for tonight, we will be listening to Dr. We'll be listening to Dr. Li An-Jui. He is an associate professor in the Department of Civil and Construction Engineering in the National Taiwan University of Science and Technology. He graduated from the University of Western Australia, His research interests include slope stability, AI application in geotechnical engineering, RPA in geotechnical engineering, and geo-based apps. And Dr. Li is also representing the Chinese Taipei Tunneling Association this evening. So Dr. Li will be talking about tunnel engineering development in Taiwan. And we managed to get Dr. Li to talk because we tried to communicate with the Chinese Taipei Tunneling Association, because actually not many people know about tunneling works in Taiwan, because it is not so much reported, but in actual fact, they have been tunneling since the 1950s. And there are so many mountains in Taiwan, and lots of these tunnels go through all these very special mountains. And I'm very sure that this evening you will have a very interesting webinar with Associate Professor Li. Thank you very much. And thank you, Associate Professor Li, for doing this webinar for us. So without any further delay, I pass the sharing to you. Thank you,
hey.
Professor Li.
Thanks for your help and introduction. And I share my screen first. Okay.
For those who have questions, please type your questions in the Q&A button below. Thank you.
Okay, is my screen can be seen for everybody? Okay, perfect. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, first of all, thanks for the invitation from the Society of Rock Mechanics and Engineering Geology from Singapore. And the second is, I appreciate Chinese Taipei Tunneling Association assign me and give me this chance to have a presentation to everybody. And my name is An-Jui Li, and from NTUST, and NTUST also call us Taiwan Tech. And okay, I give a very brief introduction to myself. I just recently got promotion as a professor, so my previous information is not very accurate. And
congratulations.
Oh, thank you. I don't want to announce this too much, even for my colleague. Okay, and I graduated from the University of Western Australia in 2009. And after graduation, I work in two universities in Australia. First one is Central Queensland University, and second one is Deakin University, very close to Melbourne region. And a lot of time I focus on my research. My research focused on slope stability a lot. And then due to some personal and family issue, I choose to be back to Taiwan, and I come back to Taiwan in 2017. Okay, and then I come back to Taiwan, I start having a chance to get involved tunneling research, and from the starting is rock mechanics, similar to my previous study. But later on, I have a chance to work very close to tunnel industry in Taiwan. And then they we want to collaborate with each other. And then recently, I just get involved in tunnel research. And here, my original research is slope stability. And then later on, due to my personal interest, is quite wide. My research actually is very diverse. So I later on developed some machine learning, deep learning, and imaging processing, optimization, algorithm, this kind of research. I apply them to civil engineering. And using that kind of technique, I developed some AI approach in civil and geotechnical engineering. And also I have some automation technology development. Okay, so that's my recent research focus. And I also have very close industry research collaboration in automation technology. This kind of funding support come from industry. Okay, today, right-hand side button, I should say thank you for those people and those industry companies. They support this PPT a lot. Okay, and today my presentation outline will including the history of tunnel in Taiwan. And then the second part, we will mention what's the tunnel development recently in Taiwan. Okay, and then we will use one case study as a Dongao Tunnel and to present what kind of development and improvement we have, and probably most of this kind of approach has been used as a, I cannot say is a very strict standard, but we use them as our general operation procedure. Okay, and then later on, I will mention a little bit for our current research and technology development, and finally give a conclusion. Okay, for the tunnel history in Taiwan, we can separate into four different periods. And first one is a beginning period. I saw it's a long time ago, much earlier than the time I was born. Okay, and then for that time, our tunnel development mainly is for hydropower and agricultural purpose. And we have a Wushanlin Tunnel and Taoyuan irrigation, this kind of tunnel development. And generally, they are small cross-section. Okay, then the second period is a growing period. I saw our government want to develop our country. So they make a decision to build a relative big project. So we have a hydropower and transportation purpose like North Link Rail. Okay, and then for the tunnel scale is a middle to a large cross section. Later on, it's a blooming period. So we have a modern infrastructure. So generally, the tunnel development is for the subway and freeway. And a lot of time, we use lots of new Austria tunneling method. This kind of approach has been used a lot. Even right now, with some of our tunnels still use this kind of approach. Okay, and then the final one is right now is a transition period. Due to some government, I should say, economic direction is changing. So civil infrastructure for the past few two decades is not that highly drawn the attention of government. So tunneling project actually going down a little bit, but recently I saw just for the past few years tunneling demanding come back again. Okay, and then for the past two decades, our focus is like maintenance and some of the improvement project has been proposed and tunnel has been constructed. Okay, here has shown some tunnels just built or under construction recently. So here we just show some completed project. I saw for the past few years, Suhua Highway Improvement Project, Taiwan dedicate lots of effort doing this job for our industry. And later on, our development gradually shift to the hydraulic purpose. So for example, we want to generate hydropower, and also we have some purpose is due to our reservoir has been built for a long time, so we have some silt or maybe mud, okay, at the bottom of reservoir. So we want to clean those mud material. So we build some tunnel for those purpose. Okay, then, as I mentioned, Suhua Highway Improvement Project has been shown here. Okay, and this project has drawn the attention for our government, and the mainly is due to here for this region, they are mountain area, so they are highly influenced by the rainfall effect. So for previous condition, when for this part, they will have a rainfall quite frequently, and doesn't matter, like right now is summer, so we will have a typhoon, and for winter, we will have a wind come from northeastern, and those winds still bring the rainfall. So generally, this region have a rainfall frequently, and I will say probably 2/3 of per year, they are always under rainfall condition. And for the relative heavy rainfall, it will cause rough fall or slow failure, and this area is quite unstable. So although those road has been built for almost 100 years ago, but we still have a lot of improvement gradually, and those improvements is in from the 1955 to 1970, but we still have lots of failure issue. So government make decision, we want to improve the eastern side traffic condition. So government dedicate lots of money to change, to improve the highway here. Okay, so that's the map. And I should say from the top here, northern side is left, and southern side is right hand side. So the proposed project is we have 8 tunnel, and which has roughly 24 kilometer, and we have a bridge 8.5 meter, and also we have a earthwork. Okay, we do this kind of design, generally we consider the environmental impact, and also using a bridge and tunnel, we can reasonably get rid of the slope instability issue. Okay, then we use the Dongao Tunnel as an example to discuss some of the approach for our Suhua Highway Improvement project. So for this project, we have some close previous project has been done before. First one is the Yongchun Tunnel. The construction was completed in 1979. And also we have a new Yongchun Tunnel, and the construction has been completed in 2003. So they can be the kind of reference for us to when we build the Dongao Tunnel. Okay, then so here has been has shown the location of Dongao Tunnel, and also we can see the geological condition. For example, what kind of formation the tunnel has been passed through, and also we can see here we have the fault located. I should say tunnel passed through the fault, and this area, due to the tectonic, has been Philippine Sea Island has met the other the main, I saw is a Europe and Asia tectonic. They have been meet each other very close to this area. So actually, the geological condition here is very fragile, and we have lots of fracture and fault appear this region. Okay, so for our previous experience, close to this region, we have an excavator jam to abandon this region. And also we have a tunnel squeezing problem appear before, and we also have the water in rush. So that's our previous experience. And here, the bottom right side, we also show the geological formation. And we can see this for those tunnels pass through many different formation. And also the water in flow section has been recorded. So probably those information can be our reference for our future development. Okay, so for our Dongao Tunnel construction, we already know previous experience, we have an excavating phase instability, squeezing, and water in rush problem. And therefore, EIA commitment of Suhua Improvement Project, we set up some control requirement. The water rules achieve 2,100 liter per meter and for 24 hours, we can say probably one day. So we should consider a suspension of construction. So therefore, to control the water amount is very important for our project. And also this kind of consideration, we want to consider the environmental condition. Okay, and therefore for tunnel design and project management, we should consider the rock selection and also drilling and blasting method. And also we have some innovative management try to smooth the tunnel construction. So those kind of innovation include the integrated the prediction of geological characteristic at different scale obtained in multiple periods. And also we have an entity difference quality procurement with lowest tender. So we also have a new risk management approach, and also have some instant notification system development. Okay, and from this slide, we can see the profile of Dongao Tunnel. Dongao Tunnel is this one. And also, the first Yongchun Tunnel is this one, that's the old one. And new Yongchun Tunnel is this one. So as I mentioned previously, these two tunnels can be our reference to build Dongao Tunnel. Okay, then we use this map. We draw the different formation on the map, and then the northern side is left and southern side is right. And then we can see lots of fracture, and those fracture is expected fracture. So therefore we use dashed line, because we just use the previous condition to predict our geological condition and rock formation. So we have a fracture, they are very close and almost parallel to this tunnel. So actually, it also mentioned, I should say it's revealed, for our tunnel construction, those fracture probably cannot be seen easily because they are parallel to each other, but it doesn't mean the quality of those rock are very good. Okay, then here, just show the slab type and mainly for this tunnel, we pass through the slate and schist formation. Okay, then for this project, due to we adopt a new approach, entity I mentioned here, we adopt the entity different quality procurement with the lowest tender. Okay, so this one, using this approach, we have to reveal geological condition first. So the difference for this new approach is this part. So compared to the conventional method, left-hand side is the conventional method. So right-hand side is a new approach. We have this part. So we have to release our geological condition. So the potential bidder, okay, they have to consider the geological condition. So they have to write a proposal and propose a good project based on their consideration. And then they still award, and if the lowest price still win the project, but for their design, they can understand the project geological condition, and then they can try to get rid of the unforeseen risk. Okay, then once they win the project, they still have a chance to get the feedback from the designer. Okay, and then here is a feedback procedure. Okay, and then finally, the design will be reviewed by the some well-established people, and then they will judge whether their project are suitable, and then they can start construction. Okay, then we apply a new approach for risk management. So, so generally, we can see the time frame. So when they submit the project, so they have a 1 month and two different level. And then if necessary, they should have a 7 days notice. And if the tunnel construction will pass through high risk area, so they should have a high risk operation. Of course, they will involve a high risk operation traffic control. And during construction, they will be monitored and the data will be collected. Okay, this one is an example. For example, for tunnel construction, pass through the Hoisan Fault. So we will have some geological condition. For example, here has been excavated, so we understand the condition. And also last hour excavation phase, so we can estimate what's the potential condition for different rock formation. And then we can plan our schedule. So for example, if we know the water in rush and they are dangerous, so we should control it. So here also, we recall the water flow amount. Okay, this one is the other project for our previous project. I saw it's a new Yongchun tunnel. We also apply a similar consideration. So we have a rock mass classification, and then we use this this kind of consideration to understand our current procedure and also previous rock formation has been passed through. And also we can predict unforeseen situation. So we use this kind of control procedure to understand our situation. And we try to use our previous experience and then to predict not just previous experience from previous project, also previous experience from this project, but for the tunnel part, we already passed through. We use those kind of information to predict our next span. Okay, then here is this figure just show the reporting personnel. So generally, the most important is if something happened, the situation should be reported in time, particularly some disaster happened. But anyway, here just clearly show, okay, who take a responsibility to get a report, and then what kind of operation we should be immediately applied. So generally, if possible, some dangerous situation happen, we should call people come back within 3 hours. Okay, then we use our, in Taiwan, we use LINE a lot, but I don't know about Singapore. So maybe in Singapore, you use WhatsApp. So, but in Taiwan, we use a LINE system. Okay, And then you can see how many people in this line group. So this line group include, maybe they can include some government people and also contractor side, designer side, and site supervision, and even the I should say the labor in the tunnel, but actually in tunnel probably the Wi-Fi is not that good, so they cannot receive the information immediately. But anyway, most of people they are in this line group, so any communication and even document, so they can be put into the line system. Okay, so using this kind of system, there is some drawback. So for example, like a line system, if we put the document in it, but those document, system will automatically delete it in 1 week. So those kind of information will be missing. So we can build up some line drawback. Okay, it's like Chat GPT in line, okay, but it's not actually line Chat GPT, but line also have similar function, so we can develop some chat robot in line, and then those kind of robot can help us to collect those information, and actually my research group also developed some line robot to service different industry company, but because different industry company will have different requirement. Okay, here just show some tunnel image. Left hand side is a river side and right hand side is a mountain side. So actually river side, you can imagine they will have more weathering effect and more corrosion could happen. Not corrosion, erosion could happen. And therefore, actually, riverside, generally, the quality of rock mass will be worse than the mountainside. So in terms of stability, of course, riverside will be worse. Okay, and then we use GSI to assess tunnel phase. So actually for Taiwan condition, roughly GSI value for tunnel phase in northern, I should say close to this area is from 55 to 25. Okay, that's for tunnel application. And my personal investigation, but mainly is in slope for northern Taiwan. And my research revealed GSI value probably between 20 to 35. It will cause instability for rock slope. I haven't been involved the rock tunnel phase, so I don't know how critical of the tunnel phase, but I understand in Taiwan, slope, roughly 20 to 35, slope will reach critical condition. Okay, then here, the tunnel show the discontinuous condition and joint state. Okay, then we can also see the potential sliding surface developed by rock displacement. And we can also see the fracture opening. It could be greater than 5 centimeters. Okay, and here also have some high fracture density. So I feel that's probably is kind of gravitational rock movement. And those rock movement in the future, it can be the rock slope failure. Okay, then if we use a distance, different distance will have different photo. So we combine them together. So probably we can observe the sliding development for those rock mass. So here, like here, it's a sliding development. So actually, if you look at the ground surface, it's kind of rock slope failure here. So that's this region. Okay, then for this tunnel close to Xiaomaosan Fault. Okay, Xiaomaosan Fault is here. So we can see the change of tunnel phase. And of course, due to pass through different rock formation, so the rock mass color is changing. Okay, then within Xiaomaosan Fault zone. So it causes instability, particularly when the water in rush. So it totally damaged the completed support. Okay, then pass through the other fault, Hoi San fault zone. Okay, so we can see the phase instability. So they look like this. Okay, then we can see the gouge from the fault zone. So actually, to improve the to solve the instability problem. So we use a lot of reinforcement method, including the ground improvement. And also we have the, so we have a drainage, water drainage. Okay, then we have some 4-point with a steel pipe. Okay, so from Dongao tunnel compared to the previous two tunnel, so we can see our average excavation rate almost double, even triple to our previous experience. And so it shows our construction technique for a tunnel. We use the NATM, this kind of approach, drilling and blasting. Our technique has been improved. And also our longest block period due to the tunnel collapse has been shortening. Okay, so it shows us we use a new material, new development of technology and technique, and also new management system. It helps us to improve our tunnel construction technique. And also for our design, we try to reduce the environmental and water resource impact. And also our construction and design technology, we try to consider the four life cycle of tunnel engineering. Okay, for our recent underground construction project for tunneling, I saw for next 5 to 10 years, we will focus on lots of urban development. So mainly they could be TBM. And not just in Taipei and New Taipei, even in Taoyuan and like Kaohsiung, we will have lots of underground tunnel. So I have discussed with some consultants, and they mentioned those tunnels will pass through lots of existing underground structure very close to land. So for layer tunnel design, they should consider not just excavation project, they also need to consider whether they will have a significant impact to the surrounding building. Okay. And also for our potential application for our tunnel, similar application will be the underground storage and also some disaster prevention issue. So it's kind of application for our right-hand side figure. You can see those application. Okay, and here we use the Xuesan Tunnel to discuss the impact of the water quality for our Feichui Reservoir and its tributaries. Okay, for our Xuesan Tunnel location is here. Okay, as you say, in this map, actually Xuesan Tunnel is not very far from Dongao Tunnel and New Yongchun Tunnel. But actually due to this region, the geological formation is very complicated. So although they are not very far, but from geological formation are very different. Okay, so for Xuesan Tunnel, we can use three different periods. So before construction is from 1989 to 2000. And during construction is from 2001 to 2006. And after construction is 2006 and 2017. So they are during, right now, of course, is during operation. Okay, so here has been recorded what's the situation happened. So for this tunnel, we have a serious difficulty. We use lots of technique, but they don't work well. So even we have lots of international contractor come to Taiwan, try to solve the problem, but they are not really successful. But finally, Taiwan, we use our technique. I saw we still use NATM method to overcome the issue. Okay, and here we have, due to we are discussing the impact for water quality, so we have lost recording situation like biochemical oxygen demand and suspend solid and ammonia, those things. And also we have a rainfall and temperature recording data. Okay, then here we found the traffic flow is the most important effect. So Thai number 9 highway is this red one, and Xuesan Tunnel is this number 5 express way, this blue line. And vehicle entrance to Pinning, they use a general consideration, because when we have a number 5 express way, this blue line, actually for traveler, they are not necessary to pass through Pinning area. they can directly use number 5 expressway to access Yilan area. So if we want to go to Pinling, we can use the Tai number 9 highway or general traffic. So we can see when this number 5 expressway has been used, and the traffic flow for Tai number 9 and vehicle and this green line significantly reduced. Okay, then due to this traffic flow significantly reduced, so actually for water quality also significantly reduced due to there are not many people access this area. But rainfall still one of the important issue, because rainfall will still influence the water quality. But the second importance is traffic flow. Okay, but recently I saw Taiwan government focus on the environmental impact a lot. So how to measure the water quality, and even like the welling water exploration. So we should have a serious control for this. So for our general approach right now is for our site investigation, we should understand, try to collect lots of information and to build a three-dimensional hydraulic water situation. Okay, and we can use some software, and we can also use some geological map to develop this situation. And then we also need to rely on the monitor situation, try to continuously revise our model, and if necessary, we should refill the water to the ground. So we have to monitor the water in rush. Okay, then until the construction finish, even during operation, we still need to monitor the changing in water. So the three-dimensional geological model can be seen like this. Okay, this model should be updated frequently, depends on our investigation. And also monitor. Okay, then using Dongao Tunnel as an example, so we can see when the excavation happened, the construction happened, particularly close to the face. So actually, the water groundwater level, we can see it drop. Okay, this part. So that's been water in rush, but after construction finish, water level gradually come back to the original situation. Okay, actually, environmental friendly design and construction is one of the main consideration in Taiwan. And actually, if we don't design this properly, it's not easy to pass through the review committee. And therefore, I saw our future, not just right now, that's our future consideration is we have to consider carbon footprint and try to make sure our carbon emission to the balanced situation. Okay, then we should, in addition to the environmental friendly, we also need to consider the full life cycle of tunnel. So in Taiwan, we are facing the false misalignment situation, and also due to we will have the surface erosion. So tunnel, original tunnel may face like slow failure situation. And also for long-term consideration, which in Taiwan, we also need to consider earthquake effect. Okay, for the fault situation, in Taiwan, I saw this tunnel close to Kaohsiung area, and we have the fault and formation moving up. So originally, we have a tunnel and bridge design, this figure. Due to its continuous moving up, so later on, we are changing our design, become the embankment field. And also, we remove our bridge and we allow loss field in the future. If the pavement continues move up, our design to allow loss pavement can be removed. And also for our electricity design and also drainage pipeline, we use a flexible design. Okay, and also for our slope design, we consider its flexibility. And similar consideration has been applied to the Da'an Da'jia River Joint Pipe Project because it also very close to the other fault region. So we use a flexible design. So for our pipe, okay, personally, I involved in my research, involved in this Baihe Reservoir anti-silting tunnel. And for this tunnel, a very new approach is, it's a very shallow tunnel. So the embedded height above tunnel is, some part is just around 1 meter, but for this tunnel construction, because we don't want to influence the transportation above, so we apply some new approach to reinforce the above the tunnel surface, and then the traffic still can pass through this tunnel during the tunnel construction. Okay, then the influence of earthquake for rock tunnel. Actually, earthquake will change the bending stress for the lining. Okay, here is due to the frequency will be changed, and that means the wavelength will be changed as well. So different wavelength for different tunnel, they will have a different effect. So wavelength is one of the important consideration for tunnel during earthquake. So here is the case. Although we have three different monitor site, but for the recording frequency, they can be very different. So different frequency, that means the wavelength can be different. Okay, then acceleration will be influenced. So they will influence the leaning stress. Okay, then for the long-term stability consideration, for the tunnel surface, before our consideration for tunnel design, just consider the short term, but gradually in Taiwan, we found long-term has a serious problem. Tunnel will continuous move and it will cause some fracture occur. So we have continuous monitor and then we can see the fracture occur here. And we use some monitor system and we use a whole transform to draw those fracture. So from the whole transformation, we can see those pattern. So using this approach, different failure pattern, we can see different, we can use those information to identify the fracture. And from those fracture, we can guess, okay, what kind of problem, what kind of issue, what kind of damage for a tunnel surface. Okay, then we still try to using different inspection technology. So right now we use like imaging identification. So imaging identification, from my understanding, some researchers, they use a cloud point. Point cloud, sorry. They use a point cloud and then they can plot the tunnel situation. Then they use some imaging processing technology. They can draw the tunnel face situation and understand the fracture condition. Okay, and that's a model look like. Okay, in the future, I saw for rock tunnel, even TBM in urban area, we still have a long way to go. So in Taiwan, we have a maintenance issue and rockfall outside the tunnel, it will cause additional stress reaction or additional overburden stress, okay? So in conclusion, in Taiwan, tunnel technology is still under development. So we have a lots of NATM practice, but we use the innovative action to improve our construction performance of dry tunnel using NATN, including geological investigation. That means we draw the 3D, three-dimensional rock formation and hydrogeology condition. And then we use a flexible tender and contract management, such as entity, different quality procurement with lowest tender and design and build contract. And also using new technology to manage the communication. Okay, we still have some challenge. As I mentioned, geological condition, earthquake condition in Taiwan, we still have lots of problem. But due to the past two decades, tunnel project going down due to government support. So most of skilled person, they are promoted to the higher level, but we don't have the first line people to in the field. So the unsigned expert reduce. Okay, even we have some development, but our inspection and maintenance of tunnel technology still need a sustained continuous improve. Okay, maintenance is our main difficulty. Thanks for your attention. And I complete my presentation here.
Thank you, Professor Li. Very, very well prepared presentation. Very interesting story about Taiwan's tunneling. So you already have two questions. The first question is in traditional Chinese Mandarin. So please take a look at that question. It's okay. In the Q&A. It's written by engineer Lau Song Min, and he wrote it in traditional Chinese Mandarin. So please read his question in English and reply in English.
Okay, I read first question first, and yeah. I answer in English, don't worry.
Yeah.
Okay, for first part of question, I talking about water in rush for serious part, whether need frequently inspection and maintenance. So for this part of question, I'm thinking about is maintenance. So because I didn't really involve this project, but I discussed with those researcher, I saw generally for this area they will set up a like a drainage pipe or drainage well, so they continuous dissipate the water. Okay, so actually, for tunnel structure, probably they will not significant influence due to loss water in rush because the water already dissipated. But I thought we should pay more attention to whether loss water will create lots of very big stress to cause the tunnel squeezing, okay, during operation. I don't know because they are still under monitoring, but so far we are not aware of for newly built tunnel, they have those problems. But in Taiwan, we have lots of old tunnel. They was built maybe more than 100 years, so they have those problems. But I don't know. It's big issue for in Taiwan. Because we try to maintain them and fix them. Okay, but there are too many, and they need lots of government budget. So even government they are headache. Okay, and then for fixing problem, because they are not fixing, so probably they don't have a fixing solution so far. And actually, Yilan, I should say Yilan is northeastern Taiwan is the intersection between two tectonic, so they will have lots of earthquake. Okay, so I already finished the answering of the first question. So I read the second question.
Professor Li, you should also click on show all. Show all. He has another two more parts of the question.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, Xiaomaosan Fault is has a more serious water inrush. The final one is, I don't know, vibration limitation, vibration, because they are in the mountain. I don't think vibration is a big issue for land, because not many people live there. So probably they don't have a serious vibration control. But in if vibration in urban area, I believe they will have some requirement. But generally in urban area, they will use TBN. So TBN, from my understanding, they won't have a serious vibration issue.
Maybe I add a comment on this. Professor Li, normally in the road tunnels in Taiwan, for example, yes. The stretch of the Suhua Highway.
Yes.
When there is an earthquake, is it seriously affecting the tunnel or not serious?
So far, I haven't heard the operating Suhua Tunnel or Xuesan Tunnel,
right.
They are serious affecting by
earthquake. Okay.
But I guess it could have some issue because I show the here. Like this one, earthquake probably will have some rockfall or landslide issue.
The rockfall or landslide is outside. So inside the tunnel, normally no accidents due to earthquake, right?
But this kind of issue will change the tunnel stress.
Okay.
So they will create further problems.
Okay. But so far, do you hear some tunnels is closed when there is an earthquake? No, right? They don't close the tunnels in the earthquake.
I don't know. I don't know whether any, but I don't know.
Okay.
But anyway, earthquake has a serious, not serious, earthquake damage tunnel or not. I saw the Professor Wang from NTU, he did this kind of research, and it's one of his main research area, but I didn't involve this part too much.
Okay. But since Tony is here, can Tony give a comment?
I think
is earthquake a problem for the road tunnel in Taiwan?
Not serious.
Yeah. Not serious. Okay. Yeah. Okay. And another question: How do you stop the tunnel from raining? 2,000 liters per 24 hour. How do you stop the tunnel from raining?
No solution. Well, the only way is water drainage.
Oh.
And we try to dissipate it. Because if water in rush greater than this setting up amount, okay, regulation. But I saw it's dangerous. So how to maintain it and how to dissipate the water is an emergency operation.
So you allow the water to remain there. You let the water rain in the tunnel, right? You don't stop it. You drain the water, but you let the water keep falling.
I shouldn't say we allow water drain in tunnel. Yeah. We try to use like ground improvement to stop it, but it doesn't mean it will work well.
Yeah, it doesn't work. Yeah. Yeah. Because so, 15 years ago, I saw this this picture, your picture. I saw it in reality. 15 years ago, I saw the tunnel with the rainwater in Taiwan. Yeah, so it's extremely interesting, but very scary. But they said they just let the water drain out. Yeah, they don't try to block it. Yeah.
I saw blocking this kind of technique rely on our future development. but drain, I saw release the stress. I saw that's still important consideration. I believe if the water without lots of particle bring out, that means only water relative okay. But if bring out something, that means critical.
Yeah. Okay. You have a second question from Dr. Lu Jinping. He's the ACI chapter, Singapore chapter's president. So Ms. Dr. Lu is asking you, what kind of waterproofing system will use in Taiwan for tunneling to prevent the water leakage?
PVC waterproofing.
Huh?
PVC.
PVC waterproofing.
Yes.
Yeah. I think this is your expertise, Tony. So Tony is from Sika, Taiwan, and he's been involved in tunneling projects for as long as I know him, which is I know him 25 years. So yeah, he has been in this business a long time. Yeah.
Yes, and PVC is the way, but I've thought if the water drainage is a lot, it's very big, large amount. Even PVC probably doesn't work well. no other solution.
Correct. Okay, another question from P. Pyo Ong. What kind of fault is it? How to treat such kind of fault? Then I think he's referring to the rock fault that you mentioned. He's asking what kind of fault and how do you treat such kind of fault?
I saw in Taiwan, due to the location of Taiwan, not every fault, but serious fault, most of land are reverse fault, most of land. But how to treat the suck kind of fault. Actually, I don't have lots of experience in this. I don't know how to answer this.
Okay. No problem.
Welcome to Taiwan. Taiwan have many the fault.
Yeah, welcome to Taiwan.
Yeah.
And Professor Lee, another question from Engineer Lau Song Min, again, is in Chinese, traditional Chinese Mandarin. Maybe you want to read it and answer in English. Tony, you can.
I saw, first of all, I don't understand like steel plate and cement, this kind of sandwich material, I don't know how it work. Okay. I don't know, I have no idea because I'm not doing the maintenance list. This kind of project. But I thought there is no Bible. So for tunnel maintenance, and we should consider the tunnel situation, like for very old tunnel. So probably the maintenance way, we should think in different way. And maybe some tunnel, they should have a special treatment. If we don't treat carefully, probably tunnel will collapse directly. So different tunnel will use different approach. So we should rely on like inspection people and consultant people, and even material site, they will propose a better solution. I can't say there is the only solution.
Tony, do you have a comment on the second part of the question from Engineer Lau?
We don't like a steel plate because we can see that there's some problem.
So you don't use steel plate because you will see that there's some problem.
Yes.
Okay. So if we install a steel plate on some damaged area, it looks like it has some problem, and psychologically, it's not good for the user of the tunnel.
Yeah. So now you can use.
Okay. Okay. Then another question from Abdullah Salahuddin. In Taiwan, normally you are using reinforced tunnel lining or fiber reinforced concrete tunnel lining. Which one is more effective? Would like to know the maximum service period for the tunnel.
Okay. From my understanding, Taiwan uses reinforced tunnel lining.
Yes.
More. And but whether which one is more effective or not, I saw from my point, I cannot judge this because I don't have much experience. Many experience in this area,
yes.
But they are under investigation. I believe last other researcher probably can give an answer for this.
Yes.
Service period.
I think he's asking you about what is the design life of a tunnel in Taiwan. For example, a Suhua Highway, what is the design life?
Concrete lining, right?
Yeah, concrete lining.
The first lining is steel fiber concrete.
Tony, design life. What is the design? 100 years, 50 years, 30 years? What is the design like?
15 years. Design up.
Huh?
Design up, right?
Yeah, design life. What is the design like?
I saw 50 is a reasonable considering.
50 years, okay.
Yes.
Okay. So after 50 years, what do you use? What do you do with a tunnel? You repair or you...
That's a service design, service issue. I don't know. Design is 50 years. No.
50 years design life. Okay. Understand.
But for our relative modern design, they haven't reached 50 years. So I believe even government haven't considered this problem.
okay. Understand. Maybe I will add something with regards to what type of reinforcement is used in Taiwan. Normally, primary lining, that means the first lining is using fiber reinforced concrete.
Yes.
And then the final lining is always traditional rebar reinforced concrete lining. Yeah. So the amount of fiber reinforced concrete lining used is always used in the so-called non-permanent lining. So the primary lining is considered non-permanent lining. So it's sacrificial. So fiber reinforced concrete is still very not so well accepted in Taiwan as a permanent lining. Yeah. So in Taiwan, permanent lining is still traditional rebar reinforced concrete lining. Yeah. So that's the additional comment that I want to make. Okay. So we have answered all the questions. And thank you very much, Professor Li. We really appreciate you doing this presentation. And we have some interesting questions which you have answered. So it is the weekend already. So I would like to wish you, Tony, and everyone who attended, everyone who stayed until now, a very happy weekend. Thank you for attending this webinar for July. The presentation will be sent to you in the next 5 or 7 days. When I receive the presentation from Professor Li, I will send it to all of you. Yeah. Hold on. Yeah.
Okay.
So with that, we will close. So thank you very much, Professor Li, and thank you very much, Tony, for helping to answer some of the questions here. And I think our audience is also saying thank you to all of you. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for all of you.
Yeah. Thank you. And have a good night. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Bye.
Yeah. Bye. Have a good night. Bye-bye.
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 Bye.